As you can clearly see, there's no section 144 here. A lot of people here. So the discussion is very interesting, the talk of data and communication, because so far data has been the forte of marketeers, pure play. We always relate data with marketeers. Now when the communication professional comes in this conversation, it becomes a different ballgame. I can begin with right from that end. So I can begin with you. If you compare the way communication is practiced now and how it used to be earlier, when it comes to the use of data, how do you see that journey? How has it come to become as we see now?
Data, I feel, is extremely essential and crucial for anybody involved in media or marketing. Ultimately, it's a messaging which you're trying to get across. You're trying to influence somebody. Which is the target audience which you're going to influence? Without data, you're going blind. Unless you have data, like I work in the Delhi metro, and data for us is extremely crucial for anything. Wherever we do our tunneling, we will be tunneling blind. Because Delhi is a city which it's already a developed city. You have sewer lines, water lines, telephone cables, etc., etc., wherever we dig. So it's what I'm saying is completely different from what you're expecting. But point is, if I don't have data on what is below the ground, I won't be able to do anything. I'll disrupt the whole city. So data, this is just an illustration. Data is crucial.
Ms. Thakur, your thoughts on this?
So I think the topic had two distinct points, right? One is how much is communication using inciting, analytics and data in designing communication campaigns. And the other component is that once they've done their campaigns, right, how actively are they able to tweak them, monitor them and measure their effectiveness. So let me start with a thought. And you also ask a question, how is it different from before, right? So, till a few years ago, advertising value equivalence or AVE, and I think most people in this room would know, that was the holy grail of measurement. It's a very rudimentary aspect and stuff, and we like to think that we move far away from that onto more sophisticated matrices, but as per the latest reports, that's the World PR report done by ICCO for 2020, in Asia-Pacific, 56% of the companies or the respondents are actually still using AVE. And you can contrast it, let's say, to UK, where only 16% of them are using it. So that's a sad part. A lot of them are still living in that. But I'm an optimistic guy, so I think let's look at the positive side of the rest of the companies which are trying to use this. The fact is, some of this inciting was driven by the fact that when PR practitioners moved from just handling the media or being conduits to media to many more stakeholders, they started using not just earned media, but the whole gamut of PESO, which is paid, earned, shared, owned. That brought with it far greater integration with the marketing folks. That brought with it a lot of data and inciting that they had at their hand. So I think most large organizations today, before they're going in for any communication campaign, it's quite insight-driven. And I think later in the session, if you come to examples, I would be able to cite quite a few which I've seen others do, what we have done ourselves, and so on. So I think both in campaign design and campaign measurement, a bulk of the industry has come a long way.
Ms. Mehra, you were telling me in that, when having a discussion, that how you use data to get the insights, you know. Could you just tell me the importance of it in the way you practice your communication marketing?
So, in fact, I moved to communications from marketing after spending about 7-8 years in marketing. So, for us and at PNG, data is the starting point, you know, because it's finally you want to reach out to your consumer, reach out to the patient. And you have to reach them, you have to first identify their journey. And for each of those things, data is important because you have to be present where they are. So that's what we have been doing. And this data comes from all sources. Now, earlier, for a long time, and many of you who have been in the industry, we used to largely depend on consumer researchers, which were very few. You had to wait for a long time Now with digital, it's just all out there, you know. So as a practice, what we do is we bring all the marketeers, the ad agency together, the PR agency together, and the digital agency together. We spend a lot of time on the drawing board, going with the objective, get all the data out there, and that's how we identify the mix. So a lot of time goes into planning. So data is through and through to start, and of course to measure along the way. What digital also allows you is to tweak, you know, because as you go along, you see what's working, what's not. So I think it's a big boon. It's complementary to what we used to do now. And so this is the way, and I think we should all leverage it as much as we can.
Ms. Patil. Same question. Has it become as important for this domain of communication as it has become for the marketeers? Is there a parallel between the two when it comes to importance?
I think when someone says that data is a new oil, it's a fact of life. I think you know, without data, you can't do communications. I mean, communications, gone are the days when it was just a fashion statement that we need to be in the press or whatever. Today's times actually you know, force us to actually base all our strategies on data. So for us at Godrej, we have 22 businesses and over 46 brands. And the fortunate part for us is we touch about 750 million consumers in this country. If data is not available, we are not able to create a strategy that's aligned to what the business needs are. So the three things that we use data for predominantly are, the first one is for the course correction of the overall communication strategy. That's the bedrock of any strategy, so data is important there. Second is to create insights based on what competition is doing, what we are doing, what's working, and what's not working. Based on that, the inciting part, that's the second pillar of our strategy. And the third and the most important point is the pulse of the market. So unless we have a pulse of what's happening in the consumer market, are people using Goodnight, are people using Amartine, or how's the competition doing? So everything is based on data. Based on that, we co-create, create, and strategize in a way that our campaigns are more effective. So I fully agree that data is the new oil, and it's absolutely important.
I think the real question is not whether people are using data or not, because I can promise you, everybody sitting in the room is using data to manage their comms programs and to take decisions. I talked about the measurement curve in the presentation that I just made. Your level of maturity on how effectively you are able to use that data is more important today. In the past, because data was not easily available, or we did not have the know-how to process that data very well, we were using very basic elements. So we were just counting exposures. We were just counting some numbers. Now, if you saw the last slide that I presented, if you are moving to an integrated level, at the integrated level, you are able to now correlate data coming in from different sets. We work with clients wherein they work with data that is available from media. They bring in internal data elements from sales. They bring in different data elements from other businesses that they have. And they are able to correlate and make sense of that data to take better decisions. So how far are you going on that maturity curve? How well are you able to use that data is a more important question, but everybody is using data.
So I mean, my point is also about the evolved state. I mean, how evolved is the communication domain when it comes to the use of data?
Right. So basics, right? I mean, all the panelists did throw a lot of light on the topic. The presidential elections, the democracy, the very fundamentals of the society is being fought, lost, and won on the basis of data. Think about it. 90% of the data that we have in the world is created in the last few years. You know, after 2015, they say the data boom. Every time we click a screen, we buy on Big Basket, or we are on Amazon, we are sending an email, we are even switching off our screens, we are creating data. If the world has changed, how is it that we will not? So there is almost a need of the hour to deal with data as is. The question, and as what he said, Aseem, was interesting, do we have, just as we say nose for news, do we have the eye for data? What do we need to analyze? Do we know the questions we want to ask of the data? I think the challenge is communicators, and the experience that we have as a reservoir will come handy in asking the right questions of the data. Computing is not a problem, storage is not a problem, analytics tool is not a problem, partners like Aseem are there to light up the way. We as communicators need to come to terms with our roles, and we got to be more intelligent, more business aligned, more community aligned to be able to asking the right set of questions. And I think that is where our focus at Tech Mahindra is. Are we asking the right questions of the data, and then are we learning from it and doing the right thing in the course of action? Yeah.
Ms. Sood, I want to come to you with this next term. So we know that data is domain. I mean, we can't be using it, and definitely everybody's evolved the stage of using in communications. But there's another factor, which is the big data, the talk around big data. Now, people saying big data itself is not enough. There's something called small data, which is more relevant. So within data, what are the bigger narratives shaping up the use of data?
With big data, the biggest challenge is how to manage so much data. And given that it takes time to get results from big data, speed also is of essence. These days, most of the time, you'll hear the word real-time data being used at all conferences. When we work with our clients, in our client organization, we divide the people into two categories. One is what we call the power users, people who are in communicator roles, like the people here. And then we have the business users, who are not responsible for day-to-day communication activities per se. We believe real-time data is only important for these power users, because they know how to assess, understand, and assimilate this data. For power, the business users, we recommend a term called slow data. We want that all the communicators are able to absorb, assimilate all this real-time data. Coming back to her point, ask the right questions of that data set, and with the analyzed results, then take those results to the business leaders rather than giving them access to real-time dashboards. Real-time dashboards at times, when given to business leaders, have a negative impact rather than having a positive impact. Therefore, for business leaders, we push the concept of slow data. For power users, we push the concept of real-time data.
Also, a small point here, it makes us very powerful as professionals to be able to go back with data analytics, real analysis to our business leaders, who often have a point of view. And if you have a point of view and you just get into a discussion without that data set, chances are that your business leader will always trump because the balance sheet is on their side. But if you really have a genuine point to make, it's always good to have data backing you. That's when you get the respect and the ears of the business leaders as well. So it is in our interest to embrace data as much as we can.
I'll give an example of what she just said. I in principle agree with both of them in terms of the real-time data and the importance of real-time data. So during a crisis situation or an incident which occurs, the natural propensity of all of us communicators to immediately try and respond. If a negative tweet comes for a brand, say for example for Goodnight, you know, one of our brands, if a negative tweet comes, the natural propensity for a brand manager or a Copcom team or a corporate brand team is to respond and try to nullify that. But we've seen in more than 10 instances where responding was not necessary, because if we had responded, it could have just become even larger, it could have reached more number of people. What enables us to take that decision of whether to respond or not respond is the availability of data. So I'll give you a classic example very recently, and this keeps happening every alternate days. So when a kind of a negative tweet comes, automatically the ORM system, the online reputation management system, which throws up real-time data, gives us the insights in terms of what is the tonality, how many people are actually retweeting it, how many people are actually seeing it. That saves us the effort of actually, you know, going on the bandwagon and try to, you know, defend that whole issue and create a larger crisis for ourselves. So I think that data, importance of data analysis, availability of data real time, and acting upon it in terms of whether to respond or not respond is absolutely necessary. And in that parlance, real-time data is really a necessary thing.
I guess I'll only take on her point of credibility, and for many of you here who would be with agencies or communicators, is a lot of time the brand team comes with a certain thought, and I think with data you actually need to ask why. And many times you should sit up and say that you don't need a PR campaign for this, maybe digital is the way to go. So that's how you build credibility, and that's how we've been encouraging our marketeers, because they'll come and the solution is completely different. And it's okay that you didn't do a campaign, but they respect you more, and then they consult you throughout the journey of, you know, the brand.
Some thoughts on the use of...
So no, I just like to reframe this a bit. I think what we've established is one, measurement and data is being used more often. That's giving more power to the power user, and thank you for calling us that, Aseem. This makes us feel good. But the reframing that I wanted to say was, what we're measuring now, which we weren't before, how important is it to the business leader, to the C-suits, to the board, etc.? Because you see, each time we go out to with our budget, how do they see it? They see it as asking for an investment, and it is their right to therefore ask for return on that investment. And for the longest time now, communication has been talking about returns such as change in the level of trust or improvement in perception, you know, the reach, impressions, etc. And they're not being able to draw that connect between the final value to the business or impact to the business, you know, impact to the business. So somewhere, we have to make sure that our analytics and the campaigns that we run are able to shorten the time to impact. So from the time the money was spent to the real impact on business. Because communicators typically ask for 3, 4, 5, 6 years time frame. Ki aaj aap karoge to brand mein trust 3 saal mein badhega, usse revenue pe impact 6 saal mein aayega. You know, and you see eyes glazing over.
Right. Also, one of the points that I sort of wanted to table, look at the data protection regime that we are in, right? GDPR now requires you that if there is a data breach, that within 72 hours, you have to actually put out a press release. You know, that wasn't the case in the past. We've just had the Lok Sabha sort of, you know, go ahead with the data protection bill. It is so important for communicators because authenticity is very critical these days. And in the age of rage and the fake news and everything else, I think there is a price to authenticity. It's so important for us to know how are we going to deal with that data? How are we going to leverage it? Because you can potentially be behind bars. So it's time that we invested a little more mind space on this one.
Mr. Dayal, do you... I mean, small data, relevant data, big data. I mean, what are the grades of data? Is whatever is measurable, is that definitely bringing you the ROI? Is that the correct approach to take when you're looking at using data?
It's an ocean of data. And I'll give you two examples. Analytics has become so important today. Apart from advertising and media, Donald Trump is suffering because of data. It was a data analyst who found out the connection. Osama bin
Laden. Side effects of data.
So Osama bin Laden, they took a risk. The data was there. One lady analyzed it. She took a risk. It was a 60-40. They took a risk based upon data available. He's no more. So data analytics, data is there. It's a skill. And as a profession, also data analytics is becoming more and more important today. Only then you can go forward.
If I may add a point here, I think it's also important to educate the marketers. I think because many times you would find people with years of experience wouldn't really know what they're looking, for. And that's where our role comes into play. And what I try and do is set KPIs right at front, ask them what do they call success. transparently tell them that this is not going to happen and that's not really the right way to look at it with examples, with data. And I think that is equally our role. If you take them on board right at the beginning, also the success is owned, the failure is owned, and the iterations are owned. So we are all working together. So I think that's a very important role. Take them through when will the ROI come in, for what activity, what should be the ROI as well.
I want to come to you, Masood. What would be your word of advice for people sitting in the room when it comes to using data for communication in terms of upgrading the tools, bringing in new technology? Can you cite an example how you are looking at implementing these kind of upgradations within your organization?
All right. My first advice is that please don't be afraid of data. These days, I'll give you an example of what happened 3 years ago. I would go out to various conferences out internationally, and I would see everybody is talking about big data and how they're using artificial intelligence and machine learning in the work that they're doing. And initially, we got a little nervous, like we were not doing that. You know, we didn't have all of that. And today, I can see the same nervousness when we look at public relations professionals who are doing PR advisory work. So the first thing I'm going to tell you is that it is not important to learn how to do machine learning. It is not important to learn how to do artificial intelligence. But what is more important is what Tuhina talked about earlier. What are the questions I can ask experts who know how to do machine learning? What objectives I can set for them? Because that understanding is very, very important. Because what has happened is, because of machine learning and artificial intelligence, the kind of detail, the kind of questions, the kind of insights that you are able to demand from experts has increased manifold. So if you don't understand what AI is capable of, you're going to be at a loss. How do you change that? You need to read about AI. You need to talk to people who are doing work in AI and machine learning on how they are able to use this in the communications domain. I think that's my advice to everyone.
And I will say this, less is more. There's no tearing hurry, because I found myself at loss of time. How do you be on all social platforms? How do you be omnipresent, right? I mean, there is only the battles that you can fight and win. Choose your battles. Go back to your business objectives. Don't be in a hurry. Don't think you're losing out in the race. As long as you're true to that authenticity and your business objective, and if you're doing justice to that, then you're good. And you don't have to be everywhere all the time, as long as you are somewhere at the right time. That is the bit that I would like to share or advise.
Ruhail, if you'll allow me to play the assistant moderator. I think the audience, we've been living in this theory zone right now. The audience would really want to know if there are some actual campaigns we can give examples of, which we may have done in our own companies or we like, where it has been used powerfully.
Absolutely. Yeah? So I just want to have this quick point of best practices of using data for communications quickly for our audience, and then we come to those live cases.
So there's nothing called a best practice. Every practice is best. I mean, if it delivers for you, it becomes best. So I think for us at Godrej, data is absolute. Like I said, it's like oil. What do we do with data? So I'll give you a classic example of evaluation of an influencer. I mean, database evaluation. I mean, we had experiences where we signed up a person who had about 12 million followers. And when the tweet went out, it had 11 retweets. It's a no-brainer. Nothing is happening, and so much of investment just goes for a toss. When we started looking at a plethora of influencers, trying to analyze what are their followerships, what are the genres in this which they write, what are their expertise, I mean, that data itself gives you the first element of reaching out to the right influencers. So I think that's one application of data being there. Second is during the crisis situation, in terms of what is the real impact. I mean, we have this tendency of overreacting, you know, writing press notes and creating, you know, holding statements. Sometimes it's actually not necessary. And my experience has been 8 out of 10 times it's actually not necessary, because we overreact. If you have right data in terms of what has been the impact, what has been the reach, where has it gone, it's a no-brainer. So we have a tool which crawls, as I speak, it's crawling 1 billion sites across the country for 18 of my brands vis-a-vis the competition. And if there's any negative which happens for any brand, I get an alert. So what does that data help me? It just helps me analyze whether I need to really respond, not respond, based on the level of incident or the crisis which happens. So I get data. Aseem sir spoke about AI. I think going forward, AI is going to revolutionize this whole thing. AI is nothing. It's very simple. It's about programming and harnessing the data which is already available. Tomorrow, if a crisis happens, micro markets can be targeted and the machine language programming can throw up results in terms of whether the impact has been good, bad, ugly. Do we need to respond? The authentic real-time sentiment based on which the campaigns can be planned. So I think there are thousands of examples which we can share in terms of how data can be really effective for corporate communications as such.
Awesome.
Maybe I'll start with the case study, and it's been really close to my heart in my previous organization. We worked on infertility awareness, and infertility, as you can imagine, a taboo subject, not much information available. So when we began, we started scouting around for information, what's available, and the researches, a lot of the data was very medical, and it's a very sensitive subject to the patient and the consumer. And then we started mining data, and it was the digital, the data that gave us the most insights. And we found every day people were actually searching for infertility-related information. There were different kinds of groups that we could identify, and we spent a lot of time listening. And our entire campaign, which was initially planned as a traditional PR campaign, completely shifted to digital. And we realized that infertility is something people want to be discreet about. So make sure you're just talking to the people you want to talk with the data on a, and we started with a pilot. We kept learning. The content kept changing. Just to give you an example, there are people who are, for example, first time going for a treatment for infertility. There are some who failed. So you have to have very different approach. We were not really selling a product. What we were trying to do is give people hope, give people information. And it completely went to a digital campaign and an always-on campaign, something which I'm very proud of, because change does not happen with a two-month campaign or a three-month campaign. It has to be always-on. That's where your digital media matrix comes into play. And now it's been third year running, that campaign, and it's touchwood given us the results that we wanted.
Just to add, I mean, the importance of data also when you file stories. You know, nowadays, if you see, media also picks up stories which have data. So I'll give you a classic example of, again, coming back to Goodnight. Not that it's my favorite brand, we have rest of the brands which we love too. But the thing is, when we were launching a newer variant of Goodnight, we had no story angle as such, because the Goodnight is a Goodnight. Only the part which changed was the efficacy part of it. So we, again, conducted a research, data. We had an hypothesis that the dengue mosquitoes bite only in the morning. Right? Now, if I go to the media, to a journalist and say, ki, make a headline saying dengue mosquito bites in the morning, he says, take a walk. I mean, it's not bitten me, so I can't believe it. So we did a research, we did a data-driven approach, and we found that 92% of the people didn't know that. So the headline which was created, this is how we frame narratives using data for PR. We frame the narrative that 92% of Indians don't know that dengue mosquito bites. It's become a kind of a de facto thing. Next day, it became a national narrative because it's an important thing. That's driven by data. How it helps the brand. Now, the moment you set a narrative saying 92% of the people in India don't know that dengue mosquito bites in the morning, which is the TG which is the most vulnerable? Any guess? Kids. Where are kids' schools have formats? No. Opens up an entire market, opens up an innovation pipeline where we came out with dots, we came out with stickers which could be used by kids in a very non-intrusive manner. That's how the business also grows in terms of having research data which is available. And that's the power of data. So data power is, I can cite thousands of examples. I mean, it's such a wonderful space.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah, and, I know.
Sujit, thank you. Now we know, India knows that dengue mosquito bites in the morning. Coming to, I think, the question I asked probably to myself as much as to the other panelists, are there some interesting examples? Now, most of our campaigns are run on the basis of insights, but these insights come out of research, which is commissioned by either the product team, which is doing viability study for a new product category, or it comes out of usage and attitude studies done by the branding department. I'm not going to talk about that. The one that I want to talk about is something which was commissioned by the communications department of one of our group companies, Max Life. So that category is life insurance, which is one heavily researched category because there are 24 competitors there. There are a lot of commission research, syndicated research, etc. It's also a very complex purchase decision. And so most of the research and the insights that were there were more about demographic-wise ownership, geographic ownership, etc. of insurance. But I think insurance purchase is a far more complex decision. So the communication department commissioned a study or a research across 15 cities, 10,000 respondents, led by a communication leader there, Abhinav Rahul, and they wanted to check, does an individual feel safe and why not? And then, of course, they layered it with what does he do to make himself more safe? And this is way beyond just talking about insurance, how they save, how they spend, how much do they spend on making themselves feel safe, etc. And then on the basis of this, they drew up a campaign which transcended both the traditional media and the new age media. In traditional media, of course, they did geographical segmentation, went out and spoke about the findings of the studies. But in the social media marketing space, there was micro-targeting done on age profiles, psychographics. There were different kind of messages sent to millennials, different to women, because it came out the need for safety and the reason is quite different. So to give you an example, a woman's need for safety was always driven from the fact on how safe her husband is and how safe her kids are as against her own safety. And even if she's working, she doesn't think of herself as the chief bread earner, etc. So the messaging was around that. And similarly, different for millennials, similarly for working men, etc. Very powerful campaign. We could show direct result to business. So, it is being used well, despite AVE still prevailing.
Those are very interesting examples. Thank you for sharing. A couple of basics for us. One, long format stories are out of fashion. How many times we hear that? Do some data analytics and you'll understand that it's far more authentic, it's used for learning, decision makers love to read curated content, and therefore, as a PR department, should we focus more on that. Some basics, everyday stuff that we can relate to. Second, we realized crisis communication is a big charter for us. And we realized when we looked at the data and we did some in-depth group sessions, we realized 50% or more of the kind of crisis situation which was rolling out was actually predictable and was cyclical in nature. And therefore, we realized, why do we need to battle this at a corporate communication level? Can we empower the organization? So what we've really rolled out at Tech Mahindra is crisis communication sensitization programs. For the top leadership, it's a good 4 to 5 hours deep learning program, and they see their transformation of skills on camera. Of course, we delete the footage and everything else at the end, but it's been, people have been awake at the end of the 5 hours. And what we are also rolling out is an e-module, but basic sensitization right at the induction level for all employees, for them to know where is that red flag, where is that button, what is the escalation, when in crisis, the 3 steps that you should take. And we believe in 18 months or 24 months, we'll be able to do away with the retail crisis, which comes every year at the same time. Then we have enough bandwidth to deal with the real ones. That is where we are required to fight and win.
Well, I just validated that point by giving another example. I'm absolutely excited to share this example because this has been the recent, and it can become a kind of a predictive crisis determination process using data. So we were, in the last 4 months, we're facing a lot of incidents. I wouldn't call them crises. Crises are end result. But the incidents which were like, could escalate themselves to crisis in our Godrej properties vertical, where customers were, because of some non-deliveries, or that's not a normal trend, okay, by the way, we're a great organization. there were some, due to conditions which were not in our control. So 6 or 7 parameters which were constantly coming up in the media as negatives, which were detrimental for the overall master brand also. We did a very simple thing. We used data of the last 10 months of national coverage for the real estate industry and analyze what are the 6 or 7 trends which are negative for the industry, on which media rights and which could be detrimental for the industry per se. We found there were just 6 key themes and narratives which were popping up with a weighted average of higher than 50%. Rest of them were chutku-putku things which could be ignored, but the 6 or 7 key things which were narratives and themes which, if taken care of during the design stage itself, would never lead to any crisis. And now those 6 steps are part of the entire planning and design process. So those risks are already embedded, and that's happened because of data. So I think your point of predictive crisis.
I want to bring in Mr. Dayal before I go to my next question. How much of, do you have any, any live example to share, the case study to share how data actually changed things on ground and the best practices, any of the best practices you would like to share?
You see, I am born and brought up in Delhi, which I feel is the roughest city in the world. How many of you have traveled on the Delhi metro, please? Can you raise your hands?
Everyone.
Great. And biggest communication issue we face is crowding. People will not allow people to deboard before they start boarding.
I thought that was a Mumbai phenomenon for the local.
So, now my next question, how many of you allow people to deboard before you board? Are you all good guys, yeah? Then I don't have to communicate, yeah. But it's a major campaign which we launched on the net. We've got a lot of films also, and we keep on talking about this also. Whenever I come on radio live, this is my last request always, let people deboard. So, it's part of our culture. In a lift also, you'll notice, you know, we have this scarcity, we have too many people in India. So, we all try to board in first. We are afraid that, you know, we'll miss this train. The same thing happens here. So, you gave me very insightful data. I think I'll have to stop this campaign immediately. We are running out of time, so I'm back to the moderator.
Brilliant. So, we have only 2 minutes. I want to make my final question in quick, like, 10-second answers. So, there seems to be this unshakable faith in data, like a godly faith in data. But data can also go wrong. What happened to Hillary Clinton, for example? So, the belief in data is great. We are practitioners of data. But is there also a fear that data can go wrong? What comes to rescue then? What is the second line of defense in those cases? Is that also part of the strategy?
Just 2 words, experience and gut, if data goes wrong.
90% of crisis communication is intuition. It's about planning it well. So data can go wrong, but if your processes of culling the data is right, you can never go wrong because data is data. It's not a hypothesis or a...
So the unshakable faith is actually right.
It has to be there, okay. And going forward, it's going to be even more higher.
It's back to asking that right questions, and your fallback is right there in you, you know.
I think our goal is one, refer always to different sets of data, not just go with one. And the other one, which I firmly believe, always have a plan B, C and D in place. So if you're prepared for the worst that can happen,
despite the good data,
always sail through.
Lies, true lies and statistics. Data can be wrong, how you read it, how you read the nuances, how many layers are you being able to read it is what can go terribly wrong.
Thank you so much. Let's have a round of applause for our panelists. Lovely. Thank you very much.